It's time for another wrestling podcast.
All right, all right, all right. Welcome to episode 158. I am Credo.
I'm Minority Mike.
And I am the infinitely awesome, angry motherfucking Cooter.
Wow, each and every week guys are doing this. Today on the show, we have a legend. Cowboy Bob Orton is joining us. He's going to be with our friends over at Captain's Corner coming up in a little bit. We'll tell you more about that as the show goes on, but stay tuned. We got the cowboy on the show today, Cowboy Bob Orton. Guys, Randy Orton's dad stopping by today. What do you think about that?
Is he still in a cast?
I was going to ask, how's the healing process go?
Probably one of my favorite foreign object gimmicks of all time.
He's the only guy that I know of that's had a broken arm for how many years now? he wrestled in the wrong era, man, because if he had the era today, man, he'd be good to go in a month.
Well, we'll find out more from the cowboy in a little bit, so stay tuned for that one. Once again, guys, girls, everybody listening for the first time, head on over to anotherwrestlingpodcast.com. You'll find all of our social media links. Like us, follow us, subscribe to us, leave us a review on iTunes or Stitcher. Let us know you're out there, basically, at anotherwrestlingpodcast.com. Guys, breaking news, we have more nude photos. Charlotte, guys, her photos have been released. What don't people get about saving nude photos of themselves, I guess? What's happening? I mean, and I might add, these probably were not the best leaks that we've gotten yet out of this. Guys, tell me your initial thoughts on the Charlotte leak. I guess we can call it hashtag Charlotte leak. That's weird, right?
May I say this? You would think that anybody on the roster, after the major incident with the fantastic videos and cum shot footage of Paige, you would maybe, delete stuff off of your phone and maybe just say, you know what, maybe the cloud isn't all that trustworthy and maybe I should just delete all the incriminating evidence off of the cloud. Just saying. That being said, this is before I saw the pictures. Now that I saw them, I'd like to pull an old favorite of mine, the Rick James card, and say, I wish I had four hands so I can give those titties four thumbs down. Just saying. Oh, God, that was brutal.
Yeah, let me explain something. This hacker, I mentioned this earlier, the hacker has to be the biggest heel in the business today. He is just striking left and right. I mean, first it was Paige, then it was Charlotte, but there's so many other ones out there. I fell down a rabbit hole today, actually. I was looking through Charlotte's nudes, and I literally a rabbit hole, because I kept digging deeper. I found who's the chick in the Trish Stratus era? What's her name? She was in TNA.
Christy Hemme.
No, well, she's already in Playboy. I'll have to find it. I have it on my phone. She has pretty nice titties.
Oh, anyway, SoCalVal.
I'm talking about nice titties. Charlotte, on the other hand, does not have nice titties.
All I think about is, like, you know those eyes you stick on things and they, like, when you shake it, they, like, look each way, like crazy eyes?
Yeah.
That's all I'm thinking about.
Zoomed in on them, and I'm looking at them right now, actually, as I speak. If you zoom in on one of the nipples, actually both of the nipples, there's, like, this little black little mark, like, on the middle of the nipple. It looks like an eyeball.
I wish we could see the visual of this, because Mike is literally, like, got his phone in his hand looking at these pictures, like, pointing it out like it's a diagram. And more
Exhibit A, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, I mean, we got to start doing visual podcasts. Yeah. That being said, please don't point that picture at me. Christ. I want to give...
She's got no hips.
Well, if he points it at us, one's looking at you, one's looking at me. It's kind of awkward. Man, how much is she... Come on, I know you kind of make some decent money down there, but come on. Did you go to, like, this guy Vinny in the back of the alley in his car one night to get this job done?
That's literally what I wanted to say, Credo. I mean, if we're grading, these are supposed to be surgically enhanced tatas, and my God, These are an F minus.
Damn, girl, you need to go to like the Dominican Republic and get the real jobs done.
Yeah.
I'm still looking at the boobs right now, and her right boob is sagging lower than her
it's
left
like drooping.
Boob.
It's like
yeah.
a sad.
It's like a teardrop, and like she has like from the below the breast down is like it looks like an old person's body. It's just weird looking.
Bipolar titties. One of them's like up in the air, happy, and the other one's like drooping.
It's not good. It's really not good when your nudes leak and people are like, it's just weird looking. It's just like at least Paige, people were just like, oh, she's got some nice tits, you know, she looks good naked. But this with Charlotte, it's like, it's just maybe you shouldn't have taken that picture. Maybe you should have just maybe kept your wrestling gear on, perhaps, and took this picture.
She did release a statement. She said, private photos of mine were stolen and shared publicly without my consent. These images must be removed from the internet immediately.
Yeah.
Like, come on.
Good luck. Good luck with that.
Yeah.
All right,
you know
guys,
what the greatest
take
part about those pictures is? Can we say one thing? Is the WWE phone cover, the case over her phone? Like, that's the funniest part. Like, she's taking a selfie and all you see is the WWE logo on her phone. Way to advertise who you are and, oh, God, who you work for.
I know who did this. I know who hacked it. Your boy James Ellsworth, man. He's got to stay committed to this storyline with him in the welcome committee. Welcome Charlotte in. I know it's part of the storyline. James Ellsworth hacked Charlotte's phone, posted those nudes. Now maybe that's going to bring Charlotte off her high horse so the other women can get a chance. It's a good way to commit to a storyline.
The day they have James Ellsworth's photos leaked, I will quit this podcast. We're not going to do it anymore because I'm not talking about it. I will go
you
on
know
strike until
James
it's not in the news. It's all I can think of is like, it's like his chin. It's just like, all right, we're already talking about it. I can't talk about it. Let's get out of this and get right into the week that was, please. Payback happened this weekend, the first pay-per-view since WrestleMania. Guys, without going through every single match, maybe you can just maybe give me a grade. How would you grade this pay-per-view as being the first one back, or the first one since Mania? I don't know. Did it hit or miss?
Womp womp. I give it like a C, literally. House of Horrors. I mean, we can criticize this all day. I don't even want to start with that. There's no heavyweight title match on there. No IC title match either. The only decent matches for me were the tag match and the women's match. Alexa Bliss and Bayley sold me on the one good match of the night. And, you know, the one good tag match. I mean, these two, Cesaro and Sheamus, you hated it when they got put together, Credo. And I'm telling you, I always had high hopes. They're a great well-oiled team now, man. I'm really enjoying their work. And this feud with the Hardys, I mean, it's been fun. I hope they keep it up, man. I think we're going to see a little brokenage soon, shall we?
I'm going to grade Payback simply with a D. Just a D, not a D minus, not a D plus, just a D, simply because it was just not a good show. I really enjoyed the tag title match. The crowd was alive for that match, and then after that match, they just faded away. I don't think they cared about the House of Horrors. Obviously, if you saw the videos that were out there, which we'll get into those a little later, I just did not like the pay-per-view at all. I thought it was a waste of me sitting there. I could have watched Raw. I could have. It was just bad overall. It really was. I mean, the main event wasn't too bad. I like Braun Strowman. He's over. But other than that, it just wasn't a good show at all.
Yeah. I mean, Payback, okay? Granted, we know we're going to have some repeats from WrestleMania, but at the end of the day, WrestleMania should have been that ending chapter in the book. This should have been a whole new chapter. Started off a lot more, started a lot more feuds off. Not really rehashing or reminiscing what we just saw for how many months build up. So I get the idea that you got to have, there's some payback, or at least one match could be payback. But other than that, it's like, come on, we just want to move on with these storylines. I'm going to give it I think it's definitely going to be in that C category. I don't think it was a D category of being that bad, but definitely wasn't good, and I think the only thing that worthwhile was definitely seeing Braun just do what he does. Without getting into everything, I mean, House of Horrors, there was a lot of criticism about it. Even Joey Ryan had some stuff to say after that. But guys, I couldn't find one positive thing from just people online talking about it to wrestlers talking about it. Tell me about this. I mean, this was... Everybody just hated it. I mean, with the whole time zone difference, it wasn't supposed to be that dark at 6:30 at night in L.A., but I get it that it's wrestling. You're supposed to lose yourself in it a little bit, but at the same time, you got to realize people are going to point these things out that are obvious. Even Randy Orton had some time to shave in between the house and the ring to where, come on, guys, continuity. Like, we know how you left the house. That's how you have to show up in the ring looking exactly the same. And, man, they should have just had it in the ring, had some weapons in the ring, and called it a House of Horrors match there. I personally, being in, like, a media industry, you're looking at this match. I don't want to watch it like I'm watching a movie. They should have had one camera, follow them around the house, have it as realistic as possible. We didn't need B-roll. And that's what I mean. Like, they're covering the shots with, like, different shots of the house and stuff like that. And it's supposed to be live. You can't be going back and forth showing all this stuff like I'm literally watching a WWE horror movie or whatnot. And that just bothers me for just somebody that works with video all day. It was too movie and less live. That's just really bothering me. But, guys, you saw the criticism out there. What did you think about that and what people were saying?
I've seen some dumb shit in my lifetime as a wrestling fan. I've seen an elderly woman give birth to a hand before.
RoboCop and Sting.
RoboCop and Sting. I've seen Kane, or should I say Triple H, make love to a corpse. But nothing... I don't. This goes up there in that category of dumb shit. This is the worst thing I've ever seen. It was so bad. I hated the cheesy horror movie effect. It just didn't work out for me. It looked like a meth house that they were in. I didn't like how when you first got to the house, and I don't know if you guys noticed this, when you first got to the house, the lights were blue, and then when Bray Wyatt was leaving, the lights turned red. And that signifies you're going in as a SmackDown, you're coming out as a Raw. That was what they were trying to get across, which was still kind of dumb. The funniest meme I saw all week was someone sent a message to Fox News saying they had a picture of a heroin overdose and they were all interested, and they just send the picture of these two sitting down on the kitchen floor. I don't know if you guys caught that.
I did see that. That was funny.
It's so funny. It was just so bad. The audience, the live crowd did not like it. Mm. It was, oh my God. And this scares me. And the reason why it scares me, because I'm looking at this, and then this broken character from Matt Hardy is going to happen soon. Is this what we're going to get with WWE production, with the broken Hardys behind them?
Like, please, no.
I hope that they don't let the WWE take control of the Hardys and let them do their own thing. But if the WWE takes control of this gimmick and wants to do vignettes like that, this Hardy characters are going to be dead by September.
Yeah, somebody needs to speak up. There's a lot of yes men back there right now that don't want to tell somebody that something sucks. And guys, if you're listening, you really need to tell people that stuff sucks back there. Stop being the yes men. Stop appeasing, Vince McMahon or somebody like that. You gotta speak up and say, like, hey, we could probably do this different. Let's change it up. It doesn't need to be like a movie. I mean, someone's gotta say something. And I think everybody's just afraid to say something because they don't want to lose their job. But come on already. I mean, nobody, come on. You can't sit there if you're working there and be like, wow, this was great. We did a great job, guys. I mean, read the tea leaves. Look online. Like, nobody loved it.
The thing that really annoyed the hell out of me, it wasn't the fact that we were getting all these cheesy effects. It wasn't the time difference. All that was expected, right? What was driving me ballistic was the music. If this is supposed to be a live event and you got two people fighting yeah. in the house, why is there like absolutely terrible like piano music playing in the background? And it wasn't like it was playing in the house. It was like theme music from like the background in a movie. It was ridiculous. Mm. Who the fuck thought that shit was going to be great for something that's supposed to be a live fucking match?
Did you guys see the video of the crowd in the arena?
Oh my God, on Twitter, that was hilarious.
They were chanting boring. They were chanting this match sucks. They were doing the wave during this whole thing. Their intelligence were insulted once again by Vincent Kennedy McMahon. And he's probably in the back knowing exactly what he's doing and just trolling the shit out of us. Because I don't believe a billionaire like that is that dumb. But then again, you know, I just don't know anymore.
You guys made mention earlier about the McMahons taking control over the Broken Hearted gimmick. Here's the thing. I mean, they tried this type of thing with the Wyatt family once before, and it flopped when they did that fight where they basically were trying to redo Final Deletion. And I think it was the New Day that was involved going to the compound. As ridiculous as that was, I mean, let's be honest. The Broken Hearty thing is absolutely ridiculous, too. It's so bad, it's good. This is something that you have said to me a million times. I think with the Hardys, the difference is the acting is so good, and it's meant more to be funny. I think it would be a hell of a lot harder to fuck up, because Bray Wyatt is more of a serious character as opposed to Matt Hardy, who's he can't be taken seriously. He's just there to make you laugh your balls off and get some kind of entertainment out of it.
You know, you hit it right on the head with that comment, because I was just going to say, like, the difference between this and the difference between Final Deletion and all the Matt Hardy stuff is that the Matt Hardy stuff was taken to be funny and it was taken to be out of the ordinary and just like so bad that it was good, while the Wyatt stuff was supposed to be taken seriously. Like they did this to make you believe in it, and it just flopped horribly. It was just so bad.
Yeah, you know, and that's the thing. I think with what they're doing, I think they got to learn that less is more sometimes. Like, we don't need it. It doesn't need to be a movie, you know? Like, literally, one camera is good enough. They kind of overdo it sometimes. I can even go back to, remember that, I forget when it was. It was like a bar fight. It was Sheamus and Cesaro, I believe, in like a made-up bar for WWE.
Oh, the Irish pub, I remember,
And it's like, okay, they're having a fight, and then all of a sudden they cut to another camera. I'm like, wait, what stop? It's just all you need is one camera guy and just shoot what's happening right there, not cutting to another camera. Like, what are we doing here? You're breaking that barrier of making it's live to now it's like, okay, now we're just making a freaking a production out of this. So less is more sometimes, I guess, right?
Yeah.
But speaking of balls, Cooter, great balls of fire. That had the internet up in arms. Everybody's going crazy. They announced that this was going to be where Brock Lesnar also defends his title when they return to Dallas on July 9th. Great balls of fire. I'm trying to figure out what pay-per-view it replaced. I don't think that's even the point, though, right now. But, guys, out of anything you could call a pay-per-view, this is your one opportunity to label a pay-per-view. Whether you want to call it Mayhem, Bloody Battle, or great balls of great balls of fire. If this was like 1980 something, I would understand maybe. But are they gonna have a match with big balls of fire? Like, you know, I'm trying to rack my head around why this was great. Like, this is what's bad with the WWE creative team. Like, this is all they can create of a name for a pay per view that could possibly return year after year. Great balls of fire. Tell me, guys, what's the mentality behind this? What could be behind this? I have no idea, but everybody is kind of blown away that this is the name of a pay-per-view coming up this year, right before SummerSlam.
I can't even I'm not even talking about this. I can't. This is absolutely stupid. The name is stupid. Whoever thought this up was stupid. And the fact that we're talking about it is even more stupid.
Yeah, you said it before, Credo. There's a lot of yes men in that back. I mean, I could see Vince. Apparently, they had to change the name. It was Bad Blood.
There you
and
go.
I saw an article online, whether it was real or not, but it was something about they didn't want people going on Google and Googling bad blood, because the inaugural bad blood pay-per-view was right around the time when your boy, Cooter, Brian Pillman passed.
Oh, that's right.
So they didn't want people reading that tragedy. So they changed the name. But Great Balls of Fire, come on, man. Is Richard Pryor going to perform the national anthem?
I was just going to say, it sounds like a fucking venereal disease.
Like, is, the fuck is that this one? A shot at Taker? Remember when Taker got caught on fire walking out the Elimination Chamber 2009?
I could see the meeting, though, happening right now. Vince is like, all right, guys, we got to change this pay-per-view. All right, I got it. Great Balls of Fire. And everybody's like, yes. And in their head, they're like, fuck, I cannot say anything. Yes. He's going to fire me if I say, that's probably not the best idea, Vince. Oh, yeah? You're fired. You know, like, I can't imagine this production meeting of just being like, you know what? That's probably the best name we're going to come up with. Anything, like, fucking herpes would have probably been better. Like, venereal disease. Like, I just, you know what? I'm not trying to be too ridiculous, but, like, anything could have been better than this.
They could have brought back the Great American Bash.
That was a great
summer name for a pay-per-view.
Oh, my gosh. What are they thinking? Anyway, I don't even give them much time with that. But that's happening. That's real. That's not even an alternative fact, ladies and gentlemen. That's real. But how about Alexa Bliss is the new Raw Women's Champion and also the first woman to be SmackDown and Raw Women's Champion? Guys, is this what they needed, I think, to get that belt off of Bayley? I think they really jumped the gun on giving it to her in the first place. She never really got a chance to really work for it, I guess, on the main roster. They kind of just threw it on her. And, you know, I guess it was kind of a dud with her, I guess. It kind of fell stale because I think they would have probably gotten more out of it if they actually had Bayley work more as that underdog and fight to finally get it to where she fought once, missed it, and then she kind of had help from Sasha Banks to win it. And then, you know, so like, I don't know. But I think, you know, Alexa Bliss is a better talker, but she made some history, guys. Is this a good question move?
Absolutely. And I couldn't agree with you more. The women on both Raw and SmackDown have all had great matches since the beginning of this women's revolution. I mean, they just keep coming up from NXT, and I'm more and more blown away by what these ladies are capable of. The problem is the booking. I mean, down in NXT, it's as if we don't have the same bookers. It's more like you have wrestlers who know wrestling doing the booking down in NXT, and we have bullshit Hollywood writers who are yes men on the main roster. The problem is, yes, there is no build up whatsoever. Not to say that the matches haven't been good, but the storylines are so rushed, it's really hard to really get behind somebody, especially when you have it right in front of you, an underdog story. We don't need to put the belt on her right away. I mean, you have the perfect amount of opportunity to build her up, let her get her ass whooped for the first couple of weeks. I mean, I would have loved that, and then see her overcome that and kind of work her way up as, oh, what's the matter? You couldn't make it on the main roster. You were the queen in NXT. The shit that Charlotte could have pulled on her heel-wise would have been amazing, but no, we rushed it. We rushed that. We rushed Charlotte losing her streak, the whole nine yards. It was just like a premature cum shot on some poor, unsuspecting girl's stomach. It's terrible.
Well, I'm glad that you shoot it on their stomach and, you know, not leave it in there.
How many times have you told me you don't want me to reproduce, Mike? I mean, come on, seriously.
Oh, yeah. You're a dummy if you don't leave it on the tummy. Anyway.
I've never heard that one.
Speaking of leaving it on women's tummies, we're going to talk about this Raw women's division.
Oh, yeah.
How much of a clusterfuck? You're absolutely correct. They rushed everything. Like, I mean, they have so much talent with the women there. Before the whole shake-up thing happened, they had great talent on the Raw women's division. They could have did the greatest underdog story ever with Bayley. No, and then just when she has her shining moment, you could have Sasha do a heel turn right there and just ruin her moment. And they just rushed everything with the streak. They rushed it. Like, it's just so bad. And I feel bad for Bayley because Bayley overall is a great performer. She's an amazing talent. And it just makes her look so bad. And I don't want to take anything away from Alexa Bliss because that girl has gotten so much better since her NXT days. Like, she used to be so green and just so bad in the ring, and now she's good. And you have to give credit to her dance partners because they help her get through it, but she's doing it on her own, and she's amazing on the mic too with her heel promos. It's just I just think it's a little too soon to throw it on her right then and there. I'm just a little lost with this division. Mm-hmm. I really am.
Yeah, you know, it's like, once again, they're, you know, they can only book around the championship. They really need to figure out what to do with the other women. I'm not saying bring in, like, an IC belt or a tag championship for the women, but we have to realize how many women we have, and we have to realize not everybody can fight for the championship at once. So they're still having that revolution. They just don't really know how to connect all the dots, I guess. But, you know, titles have changed this week a lot of times, more than once. The U.S. Championship, Chris Jericho won at Payback. Then it went right back to Kevin Owens on SmackDown. We all know the writing on the wall, Chris Jericho. Right now he's going back on tour this week. So he'll probably be off TV for a few months, who knows how long. But, guys, I mean, was this pretty much Chris Jericho's best run to date? I mean, being how old he is, and just all of his accomplishments he's done in the wrestling business. He's, you know, he's had some mediocre ones, but I think this one he really turned it up a notch, especially this whole program with Kevin Owens. It was probably some of his best work, I think, in recent times. And, you know, hey, it's a shame we're going to lose Chris Jericho because I think we definitely need that kind of star power there to help put these younger guys over more. But, I mean, he did a lot on this run, and I can't thank him enough. But do you think it was too much that we had to go back and forth at this U.S. Championship as well? And I don't know. What do you guys think about that and Chris Jericho leaving?
Let me put it to you this way. This has been the best run since the heel Chris Jericho versus Shawn Michaels, where he was always wearing the suit and he was the best in the world at everything he does. These have been the most fun catchphrases, probably some of his best in-ring work, because he just looked so comfortable. Here's the thing, though. He was great as a heel with Kevin Owens. When he turned and had that face turn, it just all kind of fell apart for me because it was, they could have kept him as that heel and he would have still been over as the face. When they make him have to be like the ultra good guy but still try to keep those same catchphrases, it just seemed like obnoxious to me. I don't know. Maybe I just like when a character develop something for a specific thing. It doesn't go with them when they change. I don't know. It was a little taboo to me.
Jericho, amazing run. Like you said, it was probably his best run ever with the list. I mean, that I've never seen a clipboard and a pen be more over than most of the enhancement talent in the back. That was a great, great, amazing run he had. I think he's done. I think if he comes back in a part-time role, maybe he'll do one more match and that's it, if we even get that. I don't see him. I don't see him wrestling full-time anymore. I think he's more focused on, you know, his ventures outside of WWE with his podcast, with the Fozzy tours going on. I mean, it's, you know, it's a good run. Good run.
So this week also, former WWE superstar Sean X-Pac Waltman was suspected of carrying drugs in an airport. According to TMZ, drug-sniffing dogs were used to search Waltman due to his place on the narcotics watch list. So he's on a watch list for this. The police report 3 cannabis chocolate bars, 2 THC liquid cigarettes, and 38 methamphetamine capsules were found in Waltman's possession, and a partridge in a pear tree. Guys, he had all this stuff traveling to the UK. you know, I'm not a genius. I'm not trying to say I'm the smartest man on the earth, but if you're traveling overseas on an airplane and you're on this supposed narcotics watch list, is the last thing you want to do is smuggle two chocolate candy bars, two THC liquid cigarettes, and 38 methamphetamine capsules? Like, Sean, X-Pac, man, come on. Dude, what is going on?
I think he's a dumbass. I mean, come on, you're traveling overseas. You got to go through U.S. Customs, which is the most strict ever. And you're going to try to smuggle drugs? Come on, dude. Let's be real here. That is like the worst thing. You just shoved it up your ass or something. Try to get through customs that way. This is a fucking moron. It really is. And you know something? I actually thought that this guy, just because he's best friends with Triple H, he might be the next member of the clique that would get into the Hall of Fame. Granted, he didn't have a Hall of Fame career, but many people who are Hall of Famers now didn't have a Hall of Fame career. And now with this, he's going to be far away from the Hall of Fame for a while. The WWE is going to separate themselves for a little bit from Mr. Sean Waltman. I mean, it's just a dumb thing to do. Now, I didn't hear exactly what X-Pac himself had to say about it. I believe he did talk about it on his own podcast. So I don't know in his defense what he had to say, the situation. It's something I'm going to go and listen to. But from reading everything, and it's just, come on, dude. Like, that's the dumbest thing you could ever do.
Yeah.
And that was the other thing. He had said on Twitter that he hadn't relapsed. Oh, so... Was this like a dare then? Like, I dare you to sneak this across the border? Like, see what. Or did you need some money? Were you muling some shit? I don't fucking know. Let me just put it to you this way. I'll say what Mike said. He's a dumbass. He's a fucking dumb asshole.
That's it. You know, it's not like, oh, I got caught with like a little bit of weed on me or something. Like, he literally had like three different fucking things
ready. You're a pharmacy, motherfucker. Like, really?
Well, I guess some guys will never learn.
And he had no intent to sell.
Come on. Yeah, we're just going to eat all that on the way over, you know, just for the trip, guys. But Mike, Okada versus Omega 2 is happening. A little bit outside the WWE, but tell us about this. This is one of the greatest matches of the year. We're having a sequel now, right?
Yes, you know, we go from talking about one of the worst matches of the year to talking about one of the greatest matches of the year. You know, the bout that...
Are you talking about Charlotte's titties?
I'm talking about
matches of the year.
Yeah, the left titty versus the right titty. Obviously, the left titty knocked out the right titty because that right titty is hanging. Anyway.
I couldn't help it. I'm sorry. Continue.
But, you know, we went from the House of Horrors to the bout that many people have called the greatest professional wrestling match of the modern era. It's going to get its sequel this June at New Japan Pro Wrestling's Dominion 2017. I'm very excited for this. I mean, these guys had an amazing match at New Japan's Wrestle Kingdom. And I can't wait to see this again. I kind of see where this is going, and I know exactly what's going to happen. I could see Mr. Kenny Omega beating Okada, and Okada somehow getting a title shot at Wrestle Kingdom next year and having the rubber match. That's how I'm booking it, but I'm just going to sit back as a fan, and I'm just going to love every second of this match, guys. I loved the first one. It was a 6-star match, apparently, and this one, I hope it lives up to the potential and becomes a 7-star match. I think they can do
it. Stop it.
No, you didn't even watch the match, so.
Yes, I did.
Okay.
I did watch that match. It's a great match. It's a great match. I think it's a little... overhyped, quite honestly. That's my opinion. I mean, I think it ran a little too long, and I hate it when people are kicking out of like 10 finishers apiece.
WrestleMania. You don't see that at all. There's a difference between New Japan and the difference between WWE. WWE, everybody's kicking out of finishers on a Raw.
I understand.
You don't see finishers or anything like that until you get to the big shows like Wrestle Kingdom. And the reason why it was so long, because it was their title match. They put a lot of emphasis behind that IWGP title. And it wasn't a match that dragged. That match went on for 45 minutes, and every single moment of that match, it just had you sitting on the edge of your seat. For me, and many other fans will agree with it. Now,
I'm not disagreeing with that.
I know.
I just think it ran a little long. Look, Mike, when you sit there and you talk about kicking out of one finisher, maybe two, all right, for the big show, I get it. But come on, I think they might have kicked out of like three or four, maybe even five apiece.
But they had storytelling behind it.
Oh,
they told a story
God.
In there.
Your storytelling.
Oh, my God.
Throw up in my mouth. Here we go.
Listen, and then if there's no storytelling, you're going to complain.
Well, I can't wait. It's going to be a good match.
is what's necessary. But when you over... less sometimes is more. We've been saying that in regards to other things with wrestling. Whether it's production, whether it's matches, whether
That's
it's...
That's so different, though. Less is more.
Huh? Sometimes
it's so different when you get to a world title. Listen, when you get to a world title,
the same fucking finisher.
Okay, but when you get to a world title match, then you want that suspense. You want something. But when you're doing something like a House of Horrors match, that yes, less is better.
Ooh, I like this guy's order. Order in the court.
Let's kicking out of finishers, and we're good.
We're going to have to go to Mark Court for this. This is great.
You're going
to
have to deal with the kicking out of the finishers at big events. You don't see that every day in New Japan. Once the finishers hit, but it was a special match, and they made it so suspenseful. They made you on the edge of your seat if you're a fan of it. The WWE does it on the SmackDown.
Guys, I'm seeing this.
Instead of coming every single day, you would rather come 60 times in one day. That makes absolutely no sense to me.
Ooh. If I'm going to have a fuck fest, yes, I'm coming 60 times in one day, motherfucker.
Wow. Stay tuned to next week, guys, when we get into... Wow, I love it. I think this could definitely... We'll have to make like an episode of Mark Court, the defendant and the plaintiff. This is great. But guys, you know, we do more than just talk about what's happening in the week, right? We have a guest this week, the Cowboy Bob Orton, brought to you by Captain's Corner. Check out Captain's Corner on Facebook.com/Captain's Corner. That's CAPTINS Corner. Guys, it's the only place to go find out where all of your favorite wrestlers are appearing in the tri-state area. Big shout out to them. Head on over there and like them. They're also going to be bringing Cowboy Bob Orton on Saturday, May 20th, to the Greater Richmond Convention Center. It's the Mid-Atlantic Wrestling Expo. Be sure and stop by. Tell them AWP sent you. And without further ado, here is the Cowboy, Bob Orton. All right, joining us today is a WWE Hall of Famer, a man whose family has been a part of the wrestling world for several decades. Please welcome the legendary Cowboy Bob Orton Jr. Cowboy, how's it going tonight?
It's going great. Thank you very much.
You will be appearing with our friends at Captain's Corner on May 20th at the Mid-Atlantic Wrestling Expo, the Greater Richmond Convention Center. For all the information, head on over to WrestleExpoRVA.com, and you can follow Captain's Corner on Facebook at Facebook.com/Captain's Corner. That's CAPTINS Corner. What would you like to tell the fans who are coming out on May 20th that are going to be meeting you?
Greatest wrestling fans in the country. And it's going to be nice to get back down there. I haven't been in Richmond since maybe 05 or 06. And so I'm really excited about getting back to that part of the country.
Sure. Now when you meet the fans, what do you get more questioned about at these conventions? Your old arm cast or about your son Randy?
Everybody asks me about Randy. And I guess the cast is probably a close second.
There you go. The Ortons have been a part of wrestling spanning several decades. Bob Sr., your dad, you, your brother Barry O, and your son, WWE champion Randy Orton. Growing up with your dad as a pro wrestler, was it inevitable that you and your brother would become wrestlers too? Or did he ever try and shy you guys away from the business?
Dad wanted me to go to school, of course, and I did, and that didn't do real well because I wanted to wrestle. And so that's kind of how that got started. I I went down to Florida and started working out with Matsuda. You were Matsuda.
Mm-hmm.
And, I guess I did okay, and I started wrestling pro, but no, Dad wanted me to go to school.
All right. Well, how about when Randy was growing up? Was it something you wanted him to pursue, or is it something that, you know, he just wanted to definitely do on his own?
I let him make his choice, and he decided he wanted to try wrestling, and good thing he did. He ended up, I think he's pretty good.
Oh, yeah. You could probably say that.
Now, yeah.
Going back now, you were involved in the main event of the very first WrestleMania at Madison Square Garden in 1985, being in the corner of Rowdy Roddy Piper and Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff in their match against Hulk Hogan and Mr. T. Now, you accidentally cost your team the match after you attempted a little cheat that backfired, resulting with you hitting Orndorff with the cast, but we just passed WrestleMania 33. Did you think at the very first one how big WrestleMania would have become 30-plus years later?
I don't know if anybody ever realized it'd be this big, but everyone knew that we was really on to something. You know, Vince really, he set the world on fire. And he had the horses, you know, that got things done. Hogan, I don't know if anybody's ever been over as strong as Hogan. Maybe Bruno, maybe back then, I don't know. Cena was awful good. Randy's awful good. Flair, of course. But McMahon's the one who made it all work.
Mm-hmm.
Got to give him credit for that.
Sure.
But yeah. And WrestleMania 1, you said, you know, that it cost my team the match, but I like to think back on it like I delivered the winning blow.
There you go.
So that's the way I got to look at it. I feel a lot better when I look at it that way.
Sure. All right. Now, also speaking of the late, great Rowdy Roddy Piper, what was it like working with him on the same team and then also, of course, on the opposite side of the ring? Do you have any fun stories about him?
Man, I sure miss Roddy. Great guy. To travel with Roddy was I don't know, never a dull moment. He was just great to be with, great to be around, you know, laughing all the time, very upbeat. He was a pleasure to be associated with. Wrestle against Roddy, you know, the same thing when you wrestle against him, the people went crazy. It was great.
You were also one of the first superstars to utilize the ropes for your finishing maneuver. Although it's done a lot more frequently today, you were one of the first wrestlers to use the superplex as your finishing maneuver. It was also very uncommon to see superstars back in your day go to the ropes to finish off an opponent, making that maneuver one of your most making that maneuver one of the most deadly of your era. How did you get the idea of using the superplex?
So Mr. Fuji had seen, gosh darn it, and I forget this fellow's name every time. It always comes to me, but it's always too late. But there's another guy who started doing that first. And he had been seen doing it by, Fuji. And he told me about it, and so I tried it and everything, and it worked great, and that's how that all got started.
There you go. You also had a chance to work with your son in 2005 on TV and being able to share some on-screen time with him. What was it like to actually, you know, now you've almost come full circle now that, you know, your son's a star in the business, and you guys got to actually, you know, perform with each other during that time.
Oh, man, that was great. I got to work with my dad, too, so, you know, it was pretty cool getting to work with Randy. And Dad, of course, you know, first, and then my career, and then, you know, getting to work with Randy was just the icing on the cake.
We had some fan questions, fans who wrote in. What was your favorite cities to wrestle in? Any cities stand out to you that you always love to go to and wrestle?
Well, everybody likes the Garden. Mm-hmm. There's no place you don't like the Garden. Let's see. Boston Gardens was fantastic. And Richmond was a great place to wrestle, too.
Sure. You know,
people went crazy. That's what we do it for as a fan.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just great to go to them places, you know, everybody gets involved and people go crazy. It just really makes for a nice job atmosphere, you know.
I got another fan question, too. He wants to know, how long was your arm really broken for? I know you had the cast on for a while, but was your arm as messed up as they said it was?
Close to 2 years, I think. It was quite a while.
It didn't heal up till probably after you left at one point?
It still bothers me.
Oh, yeah.
Still bothers me to this day.
I got another question. Did doing the flower shop segments with Adrian Adonis, did that make you nervous about doing those kind of segments because they were kind of a little bit different back then?
Well, my grandmother had ran a tavern in Kansas City. And there was a few of the gay folks who would stop by there coming in from the other across the state line to get beer to go. So, you know, I just sort of had one of them guys who came in there, you know, and I kind of had him in mind when I did that, you know, just a little bit of a swish. Mm-hmm. It was kind of fun. You know, I wasn't scared about it or anything. It was fun to do. What the heck?
Sure.
I'm pretty sure with the pink cowboy hat, everybody got the message.
Sure. And one last question from a fan out there, too. They just want to know, does any fun story come to you about traveling on the road back then? Does anything fun pop in your head about traveling back then?
Well, I'll tell you, we had a lot of trips, and we had a lot of fun on the road. There's no doubt about it. You know, riding with Piper made, you know, like I was sitting in what do they call them things? The Def Comedy Jam things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was just great. You know, the trips flew by. You just had a lot of fun. Did a lot of talking. I had a lot of fun on the road. You was away from your family.
Mm-hmm.
So if you had fun on the road, that was a plus.
Sure.
Sure.
There's a lot of young wrestlers out there getting into the business. Would you give them any advice, maybe, of somebody who's actually pursuing to be a wrestler right now? Any advice you can get from the cowboy?
Oh, listen and learn. You know, don't feel like you know everything because you don't.
Mm-hmm.
And I still would learn something, you know, at this day if I got back into messing around with stuff. You never stop learning.
That's right. Well, Mr. Cowboy Bob Orton Jr., thank you so much. We really appreciate your time tonight. And once again, for the fans listening out there, make sure you head on over on May 20th to the Mid-Atlantic Wrestling Expo at the Greater Richmond Convention Center. You can meet Mr. Cowboy Bob Orton Jr. With Captain's Corner. Make sure you check out Captain's Corner on Facebook, facebook.com/Captain's Corner. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We really appreciate it, and we'll hope to talk to you down the line.
All righty, my pleasure. There's going to be a lot of guys at Head Expo. If you're a wrestling fan, get down there. It's going to be worth it.
Today's show is brought to you by...
This is your Olympic hero, Kurt Angle, and you're listening to another wrestling podcast in association with CelebVM. Order a personal video message from me and many other wrestlers and celebrities now. Oh, it's true. It's damn true.
Get a personal video message for yourself or as a gift for someone else. For personal connections, shout-outs, birthdays, proposals, weddings, and much more. Enter your details about yourself so the celebrity can record a personal video message especially for you, including details such as your name, age, birthday, hobbies, or whatever else you include. As soon as the video has been recorded, you'll get an email with your link so you can share it on social media or download and keep it. Celebrities record videos as and when they can, usually within 2 weeks. But if you want a video for a specific date and it does not look like it will arrive in time, you can cancel it and get an instant refund at the click of a button. There are hundreds of celebrities to choose from and many more joining every day. Search by category or genre, buy a gift voucher, get updates and offers, and encourage your favorite celebrities to join so they can connect with fans in a fun and unique way, raise money for their charities, and much more. So order your video now for yourself or for someone else.
Celebrity Video Messages and Another Wrestling Podcast team up. Be sure to head on over to celebvm.com/AWP.
Promo of the week.
Commissioner's halfway up my butt about this ascension paperwork. It's really the part of the job that I hate.
Good news is that we closed the case on ascension last week, but we've got bigger fish to fry, my friend. Check it out.
What do you got, Tiffany Dango? The Uggos. Run through the case for me again.
Let's see, they stole the SmackDown tag team titles from American Alpha.
Grand theft.
They used to do an ugly dance during their entrance.
Disorderly conduct.
They're twins.
Identity theft.
No one wants them around.
Unlawful assembly.
They walk around backstage like they own the place.
Oh, that's jaywalking.
And Jimmy walking.
Nice.
The Uggos applied their face paint wrong.
Visual assault.
Their outfits actually hurt my eyes.
Assault resulting in actual bodily harm. I got it. The big bust goes down May 21st. Chicago.
The old Windy Apple.
My kind of town. Backlash.
Yeah, good work.
Dango, we need you downtown. We got a fashion fella walking around with socks and flip-flops. I repeat, socks and flip-flops.
Never ends.
Well, here we go again.
Let's get to work.
Come on.
Let's get right into this. You know, titles everywhere. Yeah, I'm a big fan of championships. Whatever you want to call it, a title, a championship, whatever. You know, through the years, we've had many championships. I'm a big fan of the Winged Eagle, the old 80s championship. I love the design. I even have it. It's the only championship I actually own, framed and signed by none other than Bret Hart. Thank you, Cooter. That's right.
Oh, yeah, I remember. Yeah, I chipped in for that one. Well, bachelor, you know, party gift, yeah.
It's one of my favorites. But let's talk about some of these championships now versus then. I want to hear your guys' thoughts about this because, you know, they've changed over the years, rightfully so, some of them, just because you got to change with the times, right? You got to update the design a little bit, make it, you know, just refresh it a little bit. Sometimes, though, it might not be good to change it. Sometimes, you know, the titles, the championship is just perfect as it is. But let me run down some championships with you. I want your guys' take on it, whether you loved it, you hated it, just all that kind of stuff. Let's start off with the biggest one we can, the WWE Championship, the World WWE Heavyweight Championship, split into two. Now we have the Universal Championship missing in action. The WWE Championship, can we compare that maybe, you know, would you compare those to the Winged Eagle, my favorite one, or, you know, even the WCW World Championship a lot of people loved? Those top titles, guys, what'd you love about them? Is there one out there that you really love now versus then?
Jeez, I'm trying to think. Because they changed that title, I want to say like two times maybe before they did the Winged Eagle one. I remember when the Sheik had it. It was like a round with green straps.
Green strap on that with the Sheik.
Right. And then Hogan, when he got it, it was some weird, like, weird shaped one. Oh. It almost had like a hump on the top of it.
Yeah, it was like an oval.
It looked like an oval with a tumor on the top of it. Like, it was weird, like a lump. No, I'm serious. It didn't last very long, and then they made the Winged Eagle one. So, I mean, that belt has changed hands a couple times early, I mean, style-wise. I love the Winged Eagle one, but I really didn't have a problem with the Attitude Era one, that big one, and it had to put the blue stuff on there. That was pretty cool-looking belt.
It was kind of like the Winged Eagle, almost updated to the next generation. Like, it was still kind of the same look. You had that eagle on there, just made bigger, more predominant. And, you know, right there, though, too, I want to agree with you because I feel as your main company's championship, okay, you know, that Winged Eagle is my favorite, a lot of people's favorite. And then, you know, you got to change with the times, make the belt a little bit bigger, make it more predominant. And, okay, we kind of kept the same design, but then they kind of switched to a blue strap at one point, but after that, you know, they've changed a handful of other times to the spinner, to what we have now. And do you think just changing it too many times, you kind of lose that you know, that little lineage, that history of it, because now it's just, it looks totally different. Now you got the Universal's a red strap, the WWE's still black, but I mean, changing the colors, changing the design year after year or every so often, I mean, does that kind of like lose, like, you know, that one staple in your company of like, this is the championship, the most coveted title? I hated the WCW World Heavyweight Championship, just the design, but I'll have to give it to them. They didn't fucking change it every fucking week. You know, it was like, whether, you know, when it came in from the NWA to WCW to even WWE, it was the same design. And that's what I kind of loved about it, even though I hated the belt. Do you think changing it up too many times is kind of, you know, you kind of lose that history of it?
I think that I'd like to think of the number that would be perfect for it, because, I mean, we were pissing and moaning for years when the WWE title was that fucking Cena spinner belt. And I mean, that belt must have been there, what, like 7 or 8 years, like
too
that?
Long.
Maybe even more. It was just
long.
Ridiculous. Oh, I mean, that's probably number one, my most hated belt. I don't know if I hated that one more or the WWE Divas title, the butterfly belt. I don't know which one I hated more.
I wonder how much that spinner belt weighed. That thing looked like it weighed like a lot compared to like the normal traditional belts. How much thickness it had in the front for the spinner.
That's true.
That thing must have been fucking heavy. I was just trying to look up to see when the Wing Eagled belt debuted, because for some reason I thought it was WrestleMania 4 when it debuted for the tournament. Because then technically, if that was the case, then it's not a Hogan-era belt. Randy Savage was the first guy to hold that belt, but the first appearance for the Winged Eagle belt was February 5th, 1988 on WWF's main event at Indianapolis in the Market Square Arena. The night's main event was a rematch of WrestleMania 3 main event between WWF champion Hulk Hogan and Andre the Giant. That belt made its debut and the controversy between when Andre beat Hogan and then
gave
sold
it to DiBiase, yes.
DiBiase. That was the debut of the belt. For some reason, I thought it was WrestleMania 4 tournament. That by far is my favorite title, the Winged Eagle. I always loved that title. It just It was small, but it looked so cool. And I gotta say, Hogan did make that belt seem special because he carried it a lot. I mean, granted, he was a prima donna backstage and had a lot of politics at the time. He still made that title somewhat special. And you fast forward today, you get this red Universal title that's not even on TV that you need to make special. And then when it comes back, you're like, it's Lesnar with that ugly ass title. It's so
Why
bad.
Why does everybody crap on that belt so much?
It's just
not that bad looking of a title.
It's the same one, though. It's just red, though, right?
Yeah, I think what they should have done with that title for the Raw title is they should have just kept the black straps and made red in the back, kind of like what they did with the women's titles, where you had the white title, the red, and then the white title with the blue. They should have did that with the world titles, because I think that would have looked a lot more better. If there's any graphic artists listening, and do it up, tweet at us. I want to see what it would look like in my head. It looks pretty cool, but on paper, I don't know. I'd have to see what it looks like. I hate that. I mean, I like the new NXT title more than I do the Universal title. I think that the new one looks cool.
No, it does. I think even better than that one, I think the UK title is a beautiful belt. I think that's probably my favorite one that we have right now. That belt is so beautiful.
So
it really
deep.
Is. Yeah. Yes.
If you lose that W and you kind of focus on that, you know, it does. Oh, we get it. It's a WWE championship. But you, when they, aside from WWE's or the Universal Championship, that one, you know, it's less WWE and more like, wow, this is a championship belt, and they kind of got it with that. It's just sad that they don't really have anything going on for it right now. But you know, they got one title right, I guess. Maybe they'll keep updating it. But you know, they went through a few changes with that too, with the WWE Championship and whatnot, to where they had like the WWE that was like the Attitude Era scribbled on it when they first brought it in, and then they made it bigger with the predominant WWE, or you know, the W's, and It's just like, stop changing it. They need a consistent design, and hopefully they're at that place right now. But still, you know, through the ages, you're kind of like, you're from somebody who's a wrestling fan in the 70s, I mean, the 80s, the 90s, to now, you know, it's like, what championship is that? You know, it's changed so many times. You can't just look at it and be like, that's the belt that they've always had. And it's a shame to me, I think, that they can't really keep that same kind of a design and they have to keep changing it all the time. But, you know, other belts have changed through the hands, through time. The tag team titles for WWE, at least that we're talking about. I love the 80s belts, the 90s belts, whatever you want to call them. Those were great. And then they kind of switched them over when they had the whole Attitude Era, where they the brand splits and whatnot. But the classic championships from the 80s, I thought they could live up to today if they brought those back. I would love those. But, you know, a lot of people shit on the ones that they had recently where they kind of look like big copper pennies. But then they did the draft split, the split, and then Raw had the silver version, the red, and now SmackDown has the blue and the silver. They definitely look a lot better than the little pennies that they had, but still, like, I don't know. I'm still a fan of those classic titles, and I wish somebody out there would bring those back, and maybe the Hardys could save them from total deletion, if you will.
You know what titles I did not like when it came to the tag division was when they first did the brand split and the SmackDown titles came in effect. And it was like, I don't know, it was just...
Yeah, there was a difference, just the world tag titles for them.
The world tag titles, and then was it the WWE tag
title? The WWE Tag Team Championship, and then there was the world tag team championship, I want to say, something like that.
World tag team championships were on Raw, I believe, right?
I think it was the other way around.
I would assume so, because the world title was on Raw. I might be wrong, but I'm just playing it like that.
No, I think they kept all the original titles on Raw, WWE-wise, and then moved the Undisputed title over to SmackDown, because that's when Brock signed exclusively over there. That's why they brought back another belt. And I think they might have introduced the U.S. title... I think it was already there, but they definitely did make a second set of tag titles, and where they were the world tag team titles on SmackDown. Yeah,
they were ugly.
Oh yeah, I remember. There was a lot ugly of blue in there too, from what I remember. Yeah,
yeah, I did not like those. We got to rewind it back a little bit. I wanted to say this. The one thing I hate is when a guy wins a championship and then he creates his own belt. I was not a fan of the Smoking Skull title.
No, me neither.
I was not a fan of it. I did not like it. I thought it was stupid. It like kind of killed tradition with the actual WWE title belt. I didn't like Jeff Hardy's title belt when that was the ugliest fucking belt I've ever seen.
It was like
seen.
The Divas Championship almost. It was like reminiscent.
What about the Internet Championship? Did you hate that too?
Oh, Zack Ryder's belt?
Yeah.
I mean,
I'm surprised they haven't brought that back. Not to bring it in, you know, like, especially in this day and age especially with their network and whatnot. I'm a fan of championships. I would love to see 20 champions. You know, I want to see every kind of championship in there. And, you know, some companies used to have the TV title and whatnot. And in this day and age, when half your stuff's on a network, I'm surprised they don't have, like, a network championship or a TV championship right now. Just to... I don't know. Some of these guys like have nothing to fight for anymore. Now all the main eventers are fighting for the mid-card titles, so it's kind of getting cloudy out there with all these championships going around. But wait, there's more than just that, guys. I want to keep on going before we get sidetracked. The tag titles we talked about, the WWE championships. How about the Intercontinental Championship? Now, I was a big fan. I never minded the design. Then in sometime in the 90s, they changed it. It was like a little oval, if you will. And I was like, it never did anything for me. I didn't really care for it. Didn't like the design. But good old Cody Rhodes brought back the old classic belt, the white belt, made it white, the classic design, and I loved it. It was like, wow, it just goes to show you that what's old is new again. And, man, it was like one of those things to where, you know, sometimes you can't really wear something that's old because it just looks crappy in this day and age or however you want to put it, but... Man, it was definitely a breath of fresh air to see that classic Intercontinental Championship brought back. to its rightful home, if you will. Did you guys like that when he kind of just brought the old school belt back? And maybe it's a shame that they don't do that for all the championships.
I loved it. I loved that white title. I said the Winged Eagle was my favorite. I feel like I'm flip-flopping now because the IC title, the white one's also one of my favorites too. It's just so traditional looking. I mean, granted, it's on a guy like Ambrose who I feel like has nothing going right now. But I do love that title. I hated the Attitude Era IC title. It was like this little like oval thing. It was tiny. I didn't like that look, and I think that was the title that Cody Rhodes got rid of. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure you're right.
That was the one, and he brought that one back. And I loved the promo that Cody had when he was bringing that title belt. When he cut the promo, he cut about tradition and excellence in the Intercontinental title. To have an excellent champion, you need an excellent title, and something along those lines. I may have slaughtered his promo a little bit, but it was along those lines. And that's what made that title a little more prestigious when he took it out of the bag and talked about it that way. And today, I mean, I'd rather see it on a guy like The Miz, truthfully.
I was really disappointed when they got rid of that original title look, like you guys said, with the Attitude Era. And I think that was around the same time they debuted the European Championship, which we have not yet mentioned.
Well, yeah, that's the thing, too.
Very different, though.
It's funny. My buddy Mario has the actual European title. He has a replica title belt, and he has, like, this man cave, he calls his bat cave, where it has, like, 5 TVs set up for we watch Sunday football, and he has the European title sitting there on, like, a case as if it's, like, a world title, like it's something special. And every time I walk in, I see all my other friends who aren't big wrestling fans, but when they see a title belt, they're like in amazement. And I was like, if you guys only knew what that fucking title meant. Like, that title was not really as big as you think it is.
Pretty much.
You know, one title, though, which really hasn't had no redesign probably since the Spinner, is the United States Championship, which I'm shocked. I'm surprised. I thought they were kind of going to make all the belts the same when they redid the women's belt and then the WWE Championship. I thought they were all going to kind of have like that similar look with the big WWE in the middle of it. But they've kept the IC Championship and the U.S. Championship the same. Does that bother you guys? I mean, has the U.S. Championship, I don't know, the look of it bothered you? Should they have changed it or done something with it? Because I remember maybe a few years ago they were even talking about just trying to merge the IC and the U.S. Championship to get rid of it. But now, with the brand split, you need like this mid-card title for guys, but it's not going on mid-card guys. Right now you have main eventers fighting for it with the absence of your Universal Championship, but the United States Championship, guys, is it, I don't know, something that's in need of a makeover?
I saw a picture online of the WWE title, the normal title with the big WWE in the middle. And then the background of it was the American flag.
Yeah.
And I thought it looked pretty cool. And I started, you know, my mind started going, like, what if this was real? What if this is what they're trying to put out there? This would be pretty cool. I think they need to change the U.S. title. That is the only title they haven't really touched since it's came into the WWE.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that belt needs a remodel. They need to do something with that to make it look cool.
It's not even a fucking year old yet.
The United States title?
I thought you said the Universal title. My bad.
I was going to say. it could be worse. It could be the Cruiserweight title.
Why are you crapping on that belt, too? Because when you saw it, you were like, oh, that's a pretty cool looking belt. It's different.
I never said that.
You did, too, motherfucker.
I never said that.
Uh-huh.
I did not like the purple belt. Absolutely hated the purple belt. I thought that was when Triple H whipped it out of the bag. I was like, what the fuck is this shit?
Somebody actually redesigned that too online and made it all black, and that shit looks sick black. I'll tell you that. I'm surprised I really have, you know, it's like you got a red belt, then you got a purple belt, and just stop. Just you don't need to have them all different colors. It's not like a Divas hair, like every diva has to have a different color hair. It's like, it's just, we get it. We can have one, the strap can be black. You could change maybe it being gold and silver. That's fine with me, but stop making it like the rainbow over here.
You with the fucking gray hair, not dyeing it? I've never seen it that bad. That's almost as bad as Charlotte Flair's tits, ma.
Come on.
No, that's pretty fucking bad.
I know, but you know, at least my hair is natural compared to that whoever did that boob job on her.
Why?
Oh my God, that poor girl. She's lopsided.